Last time, we introduced the notion of relative CW complexes, and checked a lot of examples, standard examples such as spheres, disks, and then later on projective spaces, both real and complex. We would like to study many more examples. So, in two more modules, which I have denoted by module 4A and 4B, we will only study more and more examples. Okay. For example, DN itself, you know, can be given several different CW structures. Each of them can be of use in different contexts. One such thing is thinking DN as the underlying space for mod delta n, where delta n is a n simplex in Rn plus 1. Remember, an n simplex in Rn plus 1 is the convex hull of standard basic elements E1, E2, etc., En plus 1. The endpoints of these vertices, endpoints of these vectors will be taken as the vertices. Okay, inductively having defined xk, we take the set of all k plus 1 faces of delta n as k plus 1 cells in xk plus 1 with the inclusion map as the attaching maps. The point is, we are not building up the space here, but the space is already there. We are decomposing this space into a CW complex, decomposing it into open cells. Zero cells, they are open automatically. Then one cells, their boundaries must be inside the zero skeleton. Then two cells, their boundaries must be inside the one skeleton, and so on. Okay, so this phenomena we will keep observing. So this happens to be a very special case of namely the simple shell complex. For any simple shell complex, there is an associated CW complex. The simple shell complex itself can be thought of as CW complex. Namely, the vertices are the vertices of the zero skeleton is the set of all vertices of the simple shell complex. Then the one simplex is there become one cells. So only you are changing the terminology here, that's all. Attaching maps are what? Attaching maps as well as the characteristic maps are the inclusion maps. Okay, so this is what we did. Take any triangulated space. Say X is a triangulated space, automatically it gives a CW structure. Okay. So in all these, the characteristic maps are all just the inclusion map because we have already built up the space. We don't have to build the space here. And inclusion maps happen to be injective monomorphisms, whatever you want to say, embeddings of homomorphisms. That's why these are very special kind of CW complexes. Okay. Before considering the next set of examples, let us make a few more definitions so that we will become familiar with the definitions also. A CW complex X is said to be locally finite if for each closed cell sigma, closed cell is just the closure of a cell, okay, sigma, the number of closed cells intersecting sigma in X, that must be finite. Okay, for example, take a vertex. Look at all one cells which may intersect that one, which will have that vertex, that zero cell as one of their vertices. Okay, so that must be finite. Not only that, a two simple two cell which you attach, the attaching map may find that this point whatever I have taken is in the image. Then I will count so those two cells also. So all such cells, two cells, three cells, n cells, whatever, all of them together must be a finite set. Okay, so this should happen for every simplex, every cell. Okay, the closure of a cell should have only finitely many other cells intersecting it. Let X be a topological space and F be a collection of subsets of X. This is a more general definition from point set topology. We say F, the collection of subsets, is locally finite on X if for each X in X there is an open set UX in X, okay, which will contain the point X and which will intersect only finitely many members of X. Okay, so for each X there is a neighborhood UX of X which will intersect only finitely many members of F. Okay, and let X be any topological space with two CW structures on X, which I will denote them by XA and XB, just temporary notation, just to distinguish between the two of them. We say XA is finer, okay, than XB, that's what it is, if each closed cell in XB is a subcomplex of XA. A subcomplex may have different structure than the just a cell. Okay, if you take a closed cell along with all the faces and so on, then only it will become a subcomplex in XA. So XA is finer than XB. So if you have each closed cell in XB is a subcomplex of XA. Okay, for example, this will imply that if you take all the zero cells of XB, they must be inside XA. There is no other way that those zero cells will be subcomplexes of XA. So all the zero cells must be set theoretically contained inside the zero cell of XA. But for K positive, there is no such simple relation between the K cells in XA and K cells in XB, except if you take the totality of XB, that means the K skeleton of XB must be contained inside the K skeleton of X as just topological spaces. Okay, so this is the consequence of this definition, one is finer than the other. Okay, so you can think about these definitions and think about giving some typical easy examples and so on. Okay, so let us take a more general example than just ad hoc typical example. Take a simplicial complex and a subdivision K prime of K, considered as CW complexes on the same underlying space mod K, because mod K prime is also mod K. Check that K prime is finer than K. Okay, so this will require that you know CW complexes, simplicial complexes already. Okay, so but that is what I am assuming in this course anyway. Indeed, above definition of something finer is modeled on this example. Instead of calling XA is a subdivision of XB, which will be too much, I am calling it as finer. Okay, so just extracting certain properties of subdivision to call this as a something is finer than the other, so that we can compare the two of them. Okay, so here is a lemma which will ensure how to patch up two different CW structures on the union. So suppose Z is the union of two topological subspaces, X and Y, both of them are closed subsets of Z, and have CW structures on them. Okay. Out of that, we want to have a CW structure on Z. So for this, we have to assume one more condition. Suppose for that on the intersection, the two CW structures obtained as subcomplexes from X and Y respectively are such that one of them is finer than the other. There is a subcomp X intersection Y can be subcomplex of X as well as subcomplex of Y. So you get two of them. You can call this one is A, then it's B. So one of them should be finer than the other. So this is the condition I am assuming on the intersection. Then there is a CW structure on that whose closed cells are those of X or Y. So you don't have to do any more work. Look at all those cells which are in X or in Y, then put them together. Okay. So this I am putting it as an assignment just because I want you to participate in this so that if you start thinking and working on them, so that will these things will become more familiar. Okay. So in this lemma, I have already used the definition that I have made here. Okay. So while proving that lemma, you will be automatically become more familiar with the definition. Okay. Now I come to a class of structures which are very nice structures, CW structures, which fall short of being CW complexes just a little bit. Okay. They fall short of being a simplicial complexes just a little bit. Okay. So here are those examples. They are very close to being mod k of a simplicial complex, except that instead of being built up of simplexes are what? Tetrahedrons, triangles, and so on, right? So here they will be cubes, squares and cubes of higher and higher dimension, and so on. Only in zero dimension and one dimension, the simplex as well as cells coincide. Okay. So all these n cubes are built up of inside Rn, everything is happening inside some Rn, built up of n cubes with their sides parallel to the coordinate planes. Okay. So these things will be very useful in analysis. All the time you cut Rn into smaller and smaller subdivisions. And that's precisely what we are going to do here. And then put them to good use for CW complexes. So we'll start with these subdivisions, namely what are called as lattice points. So Lk, fix I am capital N is R power N, that is the dimension. I am fixing that N. So I am not writing sometimes that N. But whenever there is confusion, I will write. So Lk is same thing as Lk power n here. Okay, this is our notation. All points inside Xn whose all of the coordinates look like some integer ri divided by 2 power k. So this k is fixed here. So the same k should come here, 2 power k. Okay, the numerator is an integer. Denominator is 2 power k. Okay. For example, it may be 2 power 0, which means denominator is 1. So these mean the all integers are allowed. Then say integer 2, 3 divided by 4, 3 divided by 8. 6 divided by 8 is same thing as 3 divided by 4. So all those things will be allowed here. Okay. So those are the coordinates of this point x, such coordinates. Let Pk denote the set of all closed n cells. So in general, I am denoting them by sigma. The n cells have side length 1 by 2 power k. So that k is fixed here, 1 by 2 power k. And with corners of sigma inside the lattice Lk. Okay, so that is pk. Take all the pk's for p greater than or equal to 0, that we will denote by p. This is just a notation. Again and again, we will have to use this notation. I am setting it up, that's all. What you have to know is that lk, all the points, the lk consists of only points, right? Coordinate, its coordinates are like this. This is what we call its lattice. Is contained as lk plus 1, contained as lk plus 2, and so on. Okay, however, for I between 1 and n, if tau is an I dimensional phase, you know, phase means what? You take a square, the square has faces all the sides and vertices. A cube has faces all the two, there are six, two faces and eight. 4 plus 4, 12, 1 edges, and 8 corners. So they are all called faces, okay? So I dimension face of a member of PR, start with a PR, take all those faces, okay, between 1 and I. It will not be a face of any member of PS for S not equal to R. Because S not equal to R just means the side length will change. So 1 by 2 cannot be thought of as a cell of length 1 by 4 or the other way around. Okay. Whereas vertices, once you have a vertices in higher things, higher, more and more divisions, more and more vertices will come. The old vertices will still remain there. For example, 0, 0, 0, 0 is in all of them. Similarly, integers are in all of them. All, suppose some coordinate has all the integers, then it is in all LKs. So that's what you have to remember. Okay. An important property of P, which is worth noticing and remembering, is take two cells, n cubes, both of them. I am taking P, that means the sizes could be different. Okay. N cubes in P, then interior sigma, intersection interior sigma 2 is non-empty, would imply one of them is contained in the other, or this one. This is what I have to say. You can also say that if they are equal, then these two are some, but I am taking two different ones. So either sigma 1 is contained in sigma 2, sigma 2 is contained in sigma 1. First of all, if both of them are in PR for the same R, then of course interior sigma and interior sigma 2 are definitely disjoint. Okay, so this doesn't happen at all. This can happen only when one of them is smaller, say one is in P1, another is P2 or P5, and so on. Then it can happen only this way, it can happen. Okay, the interior non-empty would imply sigma 1 is contained in sigma 2 or sigma 2 contained in sigma 1. Okay. So, following lemma is easy to see. Each PR, when R is fixed or K is fixed, PK, whatever you want to say, PR, along with its N cells and all the faces of these N cells, defines a CW structure on Rn, which is pure and locally finite. Okay. The local finiteness is obvious because around a point inside Rn, how many edges you will have, how many edges will come there, squares will come there, you just think about that. Okay. In R, every point has exactly two edges emanating from there. In R2, it will be 2 power 2. There's 4 of them. Okay, that's it. So you can actually say how many are there. If you take one cell in R2, whatever PR is, okay, there will be exactly two cells on either side. Right, think about that. So for local finiteness of of these structures is obvious, and this we have been using. So all the N cells, you know, their interiors don't overlap, so they will themselves be N cells. Okay, their boundaries will consist of N minus 1 cells, several N minus 1 cells. Their boundaries, several more N minus 2 cells, and so on down. So this is what the structure, CW structure on Rn. If you keep changing R, you will get different CW structures on R capital N. Okay, so these things we keep referring to them, in short, lattice structures. Okay, so out of this, you can get several interesting examples. The first example is take a KQ sigma, where K is between 0 and N. The 0 is the most disinteresting example, but you can take that when K is 0, it is just a singleton, right? So that is also a nice thing. All right. Which is a face of some N cube belonging to PR. Each N cube belongs to some PR. Okay. So I am fixing this PR here. So take a sigma, take a K cube sigma, which is a member of, which is a face of some member of PR. Then each PS, by the way, this curly PS, it denotes the C-level structure here, PR. Okay, the round, the ordinary P will denote only the N cubes. Okay, so this is just to facilitate. Again and again, I am not talking about the just the N cubes, but the entire structure here. Okay, then for each PS, S greater than equal to R. Okay, each of them induces an obvious subcomplex structure on sigma. Just sigma I am looking at. Okay, for example, suppose sigma is some edge in PR, the P2. When you go to P3, this edge will get divided into two edges. If you go to P4, it will get divided into four edges, and so on. Okay, you start with P1, for example, an edge of length 1. In P2 itself, edge, so P0, edge length 1 is P0. In P1 itself, it gets divided into two edges. Okay, so this way, you will get CW structures coming from PS on each KQ. Okay, the same holds for, let us look at WF. Okay, what is WF? I am defining all sigma, collection of all sigmas set. Sigma is in F, where F is some family, where F is a collection of some faces. I am taking the union of all of them. Like I may take some finitely many points, and then some cubes, and then some higher dimensional cubes, or maybe in between some one simplexes, two cells, and so on, various things, but finite. Okay, any collection of faces of members of PR, actually there is no finiteness in this one. R is fixed. Okay, for each S greater than to R, okay, PS will induce a CW structure on WS. Okay, why? For each, on each of this one it induces, and they will be compatible because they are all belonging to one single PS. Okay, to fix a PR, and then for each PS there will be a structure. Okay, so this generalizes the earlier observation that in Rn you can have different structures, P1, P2, P3, and so on. Okay, this curly P1, P2, P3, PR. A little more generally, let X be a union of finitely many faces of N cubes in P, of various dimensions and various sizes. Okay. Faces of N cubes. P, members of P are N cubes. If you take faces, There may be zero dimension, two dimension, three dimension, and so on. Take all this, but finitely many. Okay, so what I am doing here, here there was no quantity finitely many, but R was fixed. Now I am ranging R. I am allowing R to be different, but I put a condition X must be finite, finite collection. Okay, then it will again get a CW structure by sum S. What is that S? Bigger than or equal to R. Now what is that R? I have to tell you. Namely, choose R to be the maximum of all T such that one of the n cubes containing a member of X belongs to Pt. Okay, look at all the integers T such that there is a member Pt of which some face is inside X. Otherwise, you don't take it. Look at all those, there is X is finite, so set of all such T will be finite, so you take the maximum. Okay, maximum of all such T. That you call it as R. Then, if S is bigger than or equal to R, PS will divide all of them. Okay, very nicely. So that is the whole idea. So that will give you a structure on this X itself. Okay, so here is one example here. All right, so here you see the smallest thing occurs here. So I have divided all of them like that. The X is shown by heavy lines here. Okay, union of this large square here, this small square here, this square, square. This is the smallest one. So you cut them like this one. So that will be a CW structure on this entire thing. It's very easy to see. Okay, a finite case, very easy to see. All right. So here is, slowly we are going to build up on this theme towards making it more and more meaningful and more useful. For any k phase sigma of a member PR, okay, take a member of PR and take a phase of that. Let F sigma denote the set of all I phases of sigma. So I phases of sigma will be smaller than k, right? I less than equal to k. I don't want to one zero cells here, so one less than equal to I less than k. This is a collection of F, this collection F sigma. On F sigma, take a positive integer function such that F tau is bigger than or equal to this R for all tau. Tau contained inside tau 2, tau 1 containing tau 2 implies F tau 1 is bigger than or equal to F tau 2. So F is order reversing. Okay. The smaller the phase, the larger the integer. That's what I want. All right, take such a function. For each tau in F tau, F sigma, give the CW structure induced by the corresponding number here, P of F tau. Okay, we claim that all these structures patch up to define a CW structure, okay, on sigma. Okay, sigma is what? Sigma is a one fixed simple member, one simple phase, and all these F sigmas were phases of it. All right. So on all of them, I have a CW structure. They will put together on sigma itself gets a CW structure, which is finer than the CW structure coming from P of the sigma itself has some F, right? P of sigma F. Okay, we shall denote this CW structure by sigma F, sigma upper square, upper suffix F, just to denote the function F there. Okay, see PF sigma, this will divide the n cell sigma, the k cell sigma according to this f sigma number. But for the smaller things, the division may be even finer because the numbers are larger, or at least that much. At least that much is important. Okay, it may be finer, doesn't matter. If I have a pentagon or a hexagon or whatever, or just a triangle, okay, the empty triangle, I can, all of them I can attach a two cell to get topologically the same picture. Okay, CW structures will be different. So this is what you have to keep in mind. Okay, so we get say CW structure on sigma itself depending on this function. The function should have these two properties, that's all. Okay. So this germ of this K cells, how to cut them into finer pieces and so on. This will be of some use soon. So we do this by induction on K. I'm explaining this how this working, because the way it is done here, this is what you have to understand to patch up further more complicated things also. Okay, so let us do it by induction on K. K is what? K is the dimension of sigma itself. Suppose it is zero, that means it is just a singleton. There is nothing to do. A singleton will never get divided at all, no matter what sigma you choose for it. That is what observation I have made, namely, once a point is in LK, it is there in LK plus 1, LK plus 2, and all of that, same thing. Okay, so zero, no problem. For one means what? It is like an edge. Okay. So what you have to do? You have to look at the zero cells of that, namely the two end point and itself. The end points will never get divided. Only the simplest can get divided depending upon what you choose, and that's all. There is no patching up and so on. So for 0 and 1, there is nothing to prove. Okay. Here, sigma f is the same as the CW structure coming from P of f sigma. Whatever you have chosen, f sigma, the same thing will happen for entire. Okay. Now, assume the claim is true for K. Then we will do it for K plus 1. Okay, so now sigma is a K plus 1 phase of some member of PR. Okay, let tau belong to F sigma. Okay, yeah, sigma itself. Yeah, you can assume tau is K plus 1 phase by assuming F sigma to be of some higher dimension. No problem. So let us look at this form. The first thing to note is that the CW structure, say rho f on all the k phases rho of tau. Okay, tau has already structure because it's a lower dimension thing, right? All k phases of tau will patch up to define a CW structure on the boundary of tau. For suppose rho 1 and rho 2 be any two k phases of the same tau, okay? Their intersection may be empty, or may be a single point, or a j phase rho for some 1 less than or equal to j less than k. Because two rho 1 and rho 2 are k phases are intersecting. The phase have to be of lower dimension. In the last case, only we need to check. Yeah, 0 empty 1 case, there is no problem. In the last case, because of condition 2 above, is 2 above, the structure on the intersection is finer. Rho f is finer than the two induced structures, CW structures coming on rho coming from row 1 and row 2. Okay, it follows that this patched up structure on boundary of tau itself is finer than the seeded structure on tau, because row F itself is finer. Below that, of lower dimension spaces, it may be even finer and finer. So therefore, the structure on boundary of tau is finer than the seeded structure coming from P of F tau. So this implies that we can put them together to obtain a seeded structure on tau. Okay. So this completes the proof of the inductive step. So K plus 1 phase also you have proved. Okay. So we shall carry on these things, remember these things, we will use them, and we will try to give now examples of when we are taking infinite families of these Fs. Okay, thank you.